Welcome back. Now let's look at designing the driver circuit. I have drawn a schematic for your convenience. I begin with multiplexing all the input pins of the IC to the 8 data pins of the microcontroller. The trick here is to split the 64-bit data of the 8 pins into 8 bits of data. Now, when I pass the 8 bits of data to the first IC, followed by a low to high pulse in the clock pin, I will see the input data reflect in the output pins. Similarly, by sending 8 bits of data to the rest of the ICs and controlling the clock pins, I can send 64 bits of data to all the ICs. Now, the other problem is the shortage of clock pins in the controller. So, I am going to use a 328 line decoder IC to multiplex the clock pins. Using the 3 address pins in the decoder, in combination with the microcontroller, I can control the 8 output pins of the decoder. These 8 output pins have to be connected to the clock pins in the ICs. Now, we have to short all the output enable pins and connect to a pin on the microcontroller. Using this, we should be able to switch on or off all the LEDs. What we have done so far is for only a single layer. We have to extend this functionality to other layers through programming. One LED consumes about 15 milliamps of current. So going by that number, we will need a maximum of about 1 ampere of current for a single layer. The Arduino Pro Mini board can only sink or source up to 200 milliamps of current. Since our switching current is too much, we will have to use a BJT or MOSFET to control the layer of LEDs. I don't have many MOSFETs, but I do have a few NPN and PNP transistors. Theoretically, we may have to switch up to 1 amp of current per layer. Of the transistors I got, the highest can only switch about 800 milliamps of current, the 2N2222 transistor. So let's take two transistors and increase their current capability by connecting them in parallel configuration. A lot of people, when they adopt this method, just use the base limit resistors. But the problem here is, as the temperature changes, the current through the transistors become imbalanced and cause stability issues. So to mitigate this problem, we can use two resistors in the emitter as well to regulate the current even when the temperature changes. This concept is called emitter degeneration. We could use a low value but high voltage resistor to reliably handle the current. But I don't have too many high voltage resistors, so I'm just going to use resistors only in the base. This may cause problems in the future, but since this is only a prototype, I will handle it later. Let's assemble the circuit on a perf board. Let's start with the flip-flop IC and use an IC holder for this purpose. Always solder the first and last pins, check for stability, and then solder the rest of the pins. Let's solder the current limiting resistors. Let's also use some male headers for the sake of plug and play connectivity to the cube. We have to repeat this 7 more times. Now connect the IC's decoupling capacitors close to the power supply pins of each IC. Now let's work on the microcontroller. Again, to make it plug and play, let's connect the female pins first, then place the microcontroller. It's time to work on the transistors. 16 1 kilo ohm resistors are required to connect to the base of the transistors. Unfortunately, I do not have the required number of through-hole resistors. So I'm just going to use the SMD resistors that I have got for the smartwatch project. It's really small, so let's test with one resistor first. Great, it works. To keep the common cathode pins in a default logic state, I'm going to use a 10 kilo ohm ZIF resistor which contains 8 resistors. Finally, let's work on the address decoder IC. Alright, now the circuit is made ready similar to the schematic. We need an enclosure for housing the electronics, so let's build a 3D printed one. I'm going to make it into 3 parts for ease of assembling. First, a base plate for holding the LED structure. Second, a central body for the electronics. And third, a lid to close the housing. Let's start with mounting the LED structure. You can push the pins through the holes and directly solder it to the circuit board, but for the sake of stability, I'm going to first use a perf board, then solder it to the circuit board. I'm using a ribbon cable to solder to the LEDs, then connect the other end to the output pins of the respective flip-flop ICs. Let's connect the transistors to the cathode pins in each layer through a separate header. Before we power on the circuit, it's important to check for continuity and voltage between points. Once everything is good, the ICs can be connected and then powered on. Again, it's good to check whether all the LEDs glow by connecting it directly to the power supply before connecting it through the circuit. If all found to be good, then the LEDs can be connected to the respective flip-flop ICs. Let's do some cleanup work. Disconnect the microcontroller programming cable, cut protruding pins, etc. Now let's connect the programming cable to the body of the housing. Fix the status LED, a power switch, and finally a reset switch. We are close to finishing it, so let's put together the three parts. Let's attach the LED base plate with the body. Then once the cables are seated well, close the lid at the bottom. Now let's load a test program into the controller and power on the device. Aha! It's working! It looks amazing. But something is missing, right? I think we need a transparent box to cover the cube. Let's quickly build an acrylic box. Our box is now ready. We have to attach it to the body with some screws. I have a dedicated soldering iron for such tasks. So let's make a hole in the corners and attach it with screws. Perfect. That's it. You can download the design files from the links given below. Take a look at my Instructable page for more details on designing and programming. Thank you so much for watching this video. See you again.